Well, good morning. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Bernatova as our speaker today.
Good morning, everybody.
She earned her bachelor's degree in biochemistry at Comenius University in 1991. This was just a few years after the fall of the Soviet Union. She then moved over to the Slovak Academy of Sciences, where she's made her career ever since. She was entered into the Institute of Normal and Pathological Physiology within the Department of Cardiovascular Physiology. She continued studying while working in the lab, earning a PhD in biochemistry in 1994. This was just 1 year after Czechoslovakia broke into two, into the Czech Republic and to Slovakia. She then ran a research laboratory for several years, climbing up through the ranks, not only doing research, but also having administrative posts, such as 4 years as vice director of the Institute and director of scientific research at the Institute. The exception to that was 2 years, 2001 and 2002, when she did another postdoc in our department with Dr. Morris. The work she did here resulted in 7 peer-reviewed publications. Her focus has always been on hypertension, using L-name and stress-induced models of hypertension. The studies have evolved from the studies of nitric oxide, oxidative stress, sexual differences, moving on to the ability of naturally occurring polyphenols to treat hypertension. And I'm very interested to hear how she's going to describe why she became interested in superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles and what she's learned in her research up to this point in time. Dr. Bernatova.
Thank you. So, first of all, good morning, everybody. I would like to thank Professor Lukot for inviting me to give this presentation, actually 17 years after my postdoc at the Department of Pharmacology and Toxicology. And I will briefly present our data which are related to the effects of ultrasmall superparamagnetic nitric oxide nanoparticles in the cardiovascular system. As you have already heard, I'm from Institute of Normal and Pathological Physiology, which is now part of the Center of Experimental Medicine, Slovak Academy of Sciences in Bratislava. So before I will go to nanoparticles, iron oxide nanoparticles, I will just very briefly review the situation about biomagnetic iron in the organism. As you know, iron is an essential nutrient. It is present in low molecular weight complexes, in the solution, in macromolecular proteins, in cytoplasm, in membranes, and also in organelles. It plays a vital role in transport and storage of the oxygen, oxidative metabolism, cell growth, and proliferation. In addition to this very important roles of iron, it is also potentially very dangerous because of its considerable chemical reactivity, which results from the electrons distribution on the outer shell of the atom. In the body, the total iron content is approximately 3 to 5 grams, and 60% of the iron is bound in the hemoglobin, in red cells, or myoglobin, hem itself, or also in non-hem enzymes. 15 to 30% of iron is in storage forms like ferritin, hemosiderin, transferrin, lactoferrin. It is stored mainly in the liver, bone marrow, spleen, and practically all cells contain iron more in lower or higher concentration. However, the functional iron content is approximately 1 to 2 milligrams per kilogram, and this iron serves as a component for various enzymes. For example, for nitric oxide synthase, which produces nitric oxide, for enzymes which are involved in antioxidant defense system, in enzymes which are involved in the mitochondrial chain, in the mitochondrial production of ATP, and also in ribonucleotide reductase, aconitase, and many others. From this reason, biogenic iron homeostasis needs to be very tightly regulated, and this regulation is in both on the systemic level and also on the cellular levels. Because alterations in iron metabolism can result in various diseases. It may contribute to cardiovascular diseases, including hypertension. So it is not just only hemochromatosis on one side or other diseases which are related to with iron. So this picture shows iron turnover on the systemic level. After digestion, so iron is absorbed in the small intestine in the duodenal enterocytes, and from there it goes to plasma, where it creates a pool mainly in the when it's bound to transferrin. From this pool, it can go to different parts of the organism depending on the situation and the needs of the organism. It can be used for red blood cells, and after that, when red blood cells are, or they can be destroyed in the macrophages, and the iron is again recycled here and released back to plasma pool. From that pool, it can go also to other organs and can be stored in the liver. When there is a high concentration of the liver, of the iron in the liver, hepcidin is released. The role of the hepcidin, which is a hormone which regulates homeostasis of the iron, is to block further ingestion or absorption of the iron from the small intestine, and also the release of the iron from organs back to plasma, or to block the release of iron from macrophages back to plasma. Organism needs a very strong mechanism for conservation and internal recycling of the iron, because in some cases it is not easy to get iron from the food, because during the evolution the main source of iron was plant food, which is and iron which is in the plant is in the ferric state, which is insoluble form, which can be very difficult to digest. And on the other hand, there needs to be some limitation of the dietary iron absorption to prevent toxicity of the iron because of iron overload. In addition to systemic homeostasis by hepcidin, there is also strong intracellular regulation of iron, which is based on the interaction of iron-responsive proteins with iron-responsive elements in the either on 5' untranslated or 3' untranslated regions of the messenger RNA for different proteins which are involved in the regulation of iron, like ferritin, ferroportin, divalent methyl transporter 1 or transferrin receptor 1. This picture shows several situations which can affect the release of hepcidin from the hepatocytes. For example, disease or kidney diseases, red blood cells transfusion, for us very important intravenous or oral administration of iron. There can be some problems with genetic factors, or also infection and inflammatory diseases can increase the release of hepcidin and leading to reduction of the absorption of the iron and plasma iron concentration. On the other hand, there are other states which can reduce hepcidin release, among them, for example, chronic liver diseases and reduced function of the liver, alcohol abuse, and also, for example, sex hormones, estrogens and testosterone, which might be involved in increase of iron during aging. So this picture shows the interactions between nitric oxide and iron metabolism. I hope you know that nitric oxide, it was discovered as an endothelium-derived relaxing factor because it is a very strong vasorelaxant. And in addition to this function, it was shown it's a neurotransmitter, neuromodulator, and actually it is a very important molecule in regulation of oxidative stress and iron metabolism, which is also very tightly associated with the oxidative state in the organism. Nitric oxide was shown to inhibit iron sulfur clusters, which are, for example, in the aconitase, and aconitase has a very strong role in regulation of iron metabolism, which is based on the inhibition of iron regulating proteins. High level of NO was shown also to damage of ferritin synthesis, which may lead to elevation of iron. It's shown in this picture when there's nitric oxide synthesis in the high level, and or can damage ferritin protein, and there can be a leak of iron from the iron core. In normal situation, it would be iron would be transferred to the catabolic transition pool of iron, which would reduce and or production in the negative feedback. But in situation when NO is high, this interaction between iron and iron-responding protein is prevented. So this iron-responding protein can be bound to iron-responding element, which results in the inhibition of ferritin. In addition to this, NO can also inhibit transferrin synthesis. Transferrin is very important in transportation of the iron. And all those mechanisms together can result in iron overload. And this iron overload, again, can lead to oxidative stress, which is associated with DNA damage, changes in gene expression, in changes in mitochondrial functions, and in peroxidation of the macromolecules. In addition, it was shown that the high level of iron can be associated with a cell death, which is called ferroptosis, and this ferroptosis is different from apoptosis, necrosis, and other kind of directed cell death. Now we are going to iron oxide nanoparticles and to nanomaterials. I'm not sure how familiar you are with this topic. I would just remind that nanomaterials are all materials which have at least one dimension smaller than 100 nanometers. And this size is very important because during this, when the material is going to very small parts, the chemical reactivity of this material is changed dramatically because it is a function of the structure and density of electrons in the outermost electron energy levels. You can imagine this like you have some material with the size of a cube, with the size of 1 meter, so the surface is 6 square meters, but when you cut it twice and more, this surface is increasing and increasing, and it, because to the chemical reactivity, only the electrons from the outermost part of these particles can be involved in chemical reactions. So the same amount of the material, which is in nanoform, has a much higher chemical reactivity than bigger particles. There are several classes why iron oxides are used in many biomedical and also medical applications. It is also because when there is a size on the level of 100 nanometers, in addition to chemical reactivity, there is new magnetic behavior, which is called superparamagnetism, and I will explain this in the next slide. Classes of those nanoparticles of iron oxide are associated with the superparamagnetic properties, which can be used, for example, in tissue imaging methods, which are some of the materials are already improved for clinical practice. Some of them were approved and then discontinued because of some unexpected problems. They can be used also as a targeted drug delivery. I know, for example, there is one method is called hyperthermia for treatment of cancer diseases when nanoparticles are directed to the cancer, and when it's exposed to external magnetic field, it can be heated and the cancer can be damaged due to high temperature, which is selective to the cancer cells and not to health cells. But there is a lot of minuses which limits the use of nanoparticles. Those are immune reactions, including anaphylactic shocks. There are some undesirable incorporation into tissues. Oxidative stress is something that is the most common negative effect of nanoparticle use. There can be some non-specific adsorption to surface, aggregation of the nanomaterials, which can create clots, or also hemolysis of the red cells. And I have already mentioned that, that there can be interference with the iron metabolism and maybe with nitric oxide metabolism. What are the superparamagnetic properties and how the material can become superparamagnetic? You can see, I can explain those two pictures. When there is large iron oxide particle, it is constituted from some domains, and magnetic moments in those domains can be random, so the net magnetization of these materials can be zero or very low. But when we reduce the size and we go to one domain in which all magnetic moments are in the same direction, superparamagnetic properties can be used. And this picture shows that we have some suspension of a material in which different particles, which are in single domain, but they still may have random magnetic moments, so they are not magnetic without external field, magnetic field. When they are exposed to external magnetic field, their directions are in the same direction, the moment are in the same direction, and this is the behavior which is called superparamagnetism. And those curves explain some characteristics of magnetic materials. When the material is ferromagnetic, it means that when there is exposed to magnetic field, its magnetization is increased very quickly, and it reaches some saturation in some moment. When the magnetic field is slowly removed and it's going to back directions, at the moment where there is a zero magnetic field, there is some rest magnetization, it's called remanent magnetization. Magnetic saturation and remanent magnetizations are two factors which are very important for superparamagnetic materials or magnetic materials which should be used in applications, because it is good when magnetic saturation is big. It means that a material, organism which is loaded with magnetic materials, does not need to be exposed to very high magnetic fields because it can be dangerous for alive cells. And it is also very good with this remanent magnetization. So high magnetic saturation is the good, but the remanent magnetization should be as low as possible, because when the living organism, alive organism, is exposed to magnetic field and then magnetic field is removed, the rest magnetization should be zero to prevent magnetic interactions between particles in the organism.
I have a question, a clarification. Is the upper graph is magnetic field on the x-axis, the lower one too?
Sorry?
The lower graph,
yes.
Is that also magnetic field on the x-axis?
Yes, this is also magnetic field. And here is the curve which is for diamagnetic materials, which is without magnetization is very low or zero. And when it's combined, this curve with this line, this is the curve which is typical for superparamagnetic materials. So they can be magnetized very quickly, but there is a zero remanent magnetization without magnetic field. So the research question in our research were devoted to two fields. One field was to see whether was related to biogenic iron. Our questions were if there are differences in biogenic iron metabolism in normotensin and hypertensive rats, if there are some age-related differences in the iron metabolism, and is there association between NO production and iron metabolism in hypertension. To solve those problems, we use normotensin vista Kyoto rats. Their blood pressure is similar to blood pressure of people, normal blood pressure in people. And we use spontaneously hypertensive rats, which are the experimental model of human arterial hypertension. They develop hypertension simultaneously without any external moment or pharmacological treatment. During age, between the 4th and 7th week of age, they develop high blood pressure. Blood pressure is increased compared to normotensive AMH controls. In our study, we use 7 weeks old and 52 weeks old rats. Their blood pressure can be determined using tail cuff plethysmography. It's the method which allows non-invasive determination of blood pressure on the tail. We use these machines for that. And for determination of magnetic properties of biogenic iron, we use squid magnetometry at temperature of 2 kelvins and up to 10 tesla. And nitric oxide synthase activity is this machine. And just to explain a little bit, this machine can determine very low magnetic fields up to 10^-14 tesla in very low samples from 10 milligrams of tissue. But to determine this magnetization, very low temperature needs to be used. So here are some results from our experiment. So this picture shows the blood pressure of young 7 weeks old normotensive and hypertensive rats. So you see already in this age, they have higher blood pressure. And during aging, blood pressure of normotensive rats was also slightly increasing. That's similar like to humans. But in the spontaneously hypertensive rats, this increase was much higher than in normotensive rats. And in the left heart ventricle, nitric oxide synthase activity was increased in the spontaneously hypertensive rats compared to age-matched normotensive rats. So this shows that there may be some association between NO production, or there is association between NO production and blood pressure, but we wanted to see if it's associated also with magnetic properties in the left heart ventricle. This picture shows the example of the curves from rats. This black one is from 7 week normotensive rats. Here we have 7 weeks old hypertensive rats, and this is normotensive rat at the age of 52 weeks, and this is the old hypertensive rats. When calculating the group of the rats, the magnetic saturation of hypertensive rats was increased compared to normotensive rats, but it was also higher in old normotensive rats compared to young normotensive rats, suggesting that there is also association with blood pressure. And this is very important for us because in spontaneously hypertensive rats, the real moment or the cause of the initiation of blood pressure increase in younghood is not exactly well known. Those two pictures show the remanent magnetization and coercivity of the magnetic material in the left heart ventricle. And despite the magnetization was increased, the remanent magnetization and coercivity in young spontaneously hypertensive rats was lower than in normotensive. And this suggests that magnetic force of iron are probably different from those which are in normotensive rats, because those properties very closely depends on how the iron is complex in what are the complex materials in the tissues. And those pictures shows age-dependent changes in the liver and spleen. And here is a liver from 9 weeks old rat, normotensive rat, and this is from 20 and 52 weeks old rats. And you can see that already 20 weeks old rats had a magnetic saturation of the liver the same as old 52 weeks rats. In the spleen, the magnetization was also was increasing between the age of 20 and 52 weeks. And similar situation was found in spontaneously hypertensive rats, again in the liver of 20 weeks old and 52 weeks old rats. The magnetization was same, but in the liver was still increasing, in the spleen was still increasing. Based on those knowledge, we went to research with nanoparticles, and we wanted to know if there is a if a chronic elevation of blood pressure or acute increase of blood pressure can constitute some risk condition for spills treatment, for superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles treatment, if a low dose of spill can modulate blood pressure, heart rate, and pressure responses in stress in normotensive rats. So it is an explanation on one side if the high blood pressure is a risk factor, and on the other side, nanoparticles can affect blood pressure. And we will also wonder if a low dose of nanoparticles can modulate blood pressure and heart rate and vessel responses in spontaneously hypertensive rats, and whether spions affect NO production and some genes which are involved in iron homeostasis. For this purpose, we used adult rats of both strains, normotensive and spontaneously hypertensive, and we use iron oxide nanoparticles which were administered intravenously in the infusion in the content of 1 milligram of iron per kilogram of body weight. Again, we use squid magnetometry, and blood pressure and heart rate were determined in caution of rats, but in this case, rats had canyons in the carotid artery, and nanoparticles were administered via dual venous. Reactivity of blood pressure was determined during acute stress, which was developed by AirJet, and it is practically, it is a moment when the air of puff of air to the face of rat is given, and this constitutes a rapid increase of blood pressure. And after those in vivo recordings, rats were sacrificed, and we have determined NO production and expression of some genes in the tissues of those rats. And we have also determined vascular function using a myography ex vivo. Here are the machines which are used for determination of vascular function. For aorta, we use this kind of chambers. It's possible to determine four pieces of aorta in one time. Aorta is, of course, in the solution of prednisone solution. It must be oxygenated. And different vasoactive substances can be added to the chamber to determine whether there is a contractility or relaxation of the aorta. For small arteries, one is myograph. It has two chambers in which the artery is mounted between those two parts of the machine. And there are actually two wires are going through the piece of the artery, this direction, and the wire has 14, each wire has 40 nanometers. And again, vasoactive substances can be given to the chamber, and this allows us to determine endothelium-dependent and endothelium-independent functions of the arteries. This picture shows the characterization of the superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles we have used. We use magnetic nanoparticles in which the iron is in both spheric and ferrous form. They were coated in polyethylene glycol. Iron core of those nanoparticles was 30 nanometers according to transmission electron microscopy. Of course, when nanoparticles are created or synthesized, each nanoparticle is not always the same size of the nanoparticles, so we have to characterize also hydrodynamic size because of this coating, and it showed that the major part of the nanoparticle was about 50 nanometers, and the concentration of iron was 1 milligram per gram, not milligram per gram of body weight, and there were forecasts from the sigma Aldrich, and this shows magnetization of the magnetic liquid of the which we have used, and shows it was superparamagnetic. This recording shows already blood pressure in rats treated with spions, and for this purpose we use four groups of rats. We had controls, we had spions which were treated with saline just to see if saline infusion, 10-minute infusion, can affect blood pressure, and you can see there were no changes. Spions were also diluted in the saline, and again intravenous infusion did not change blood pressure when there was recorded in conscious rats. We had also rats which were exposed to two sessions of AirJet, and this is the first test in And then we had a group of rats which were exposed to first stress before spion treatment and the second stress after spion treatment. I'm not showing data from only stress rats because in that case, first and second stress created approximately the same response. I will show in the next slide. But when there was an infusion of spions between first and second stress, the second stress delivered 10 minutes after spion's infusion resulted in higher stress response. And those data are shown here in this picture. We have analyzed area under the curve, or blood pressure curve, in the first stress and compared to, and in the second stress, and we calculated as a percentage of the first stress. So it means we have two stresses, area under the curve of, under the first stress and the second stress compared to the first stress. So in rats which were exposed only to two stresses without nanoparticles, there were not significant changes. It was always around 100% of the first stress. But after infusion of nanoparticles, the second stress resulted in a higher response, which was approximately 45% higher compared to first stress. And data here shows blood pressure at the beginning, at the end of the experiment. So the beginning means before and after stabilization of blood pressure before any kind of treatment of rats. So in each rat we had value at the beginning of the recordings. And then we did all the procedure with infusion of the saline, spions, two stresses or one stress before spions and after spions. And 90 minutes after the last intervention, we have determined blood pressure, it means the end blood pressure. And you can see in control stress rats or spion-treated rats, there were no significant changes in blood pressure at the beginning and the end of the experiment, but only when they were exposed to stress and spions, blood pressure was reduced in the spion-treated rats. On the other hand, heart rate was reduced in the spion-treated rats, but not in other groups. After this experiment, we removed some tissues from those rats and we analyzed nitric oxide synthase activity. And in fact, there were no significant changes in the liver or left heart ventricle of normotensive rats. But we could see higher activity in the kidneys after exposure to both stimulus compared to spion-treated rats. And in the hypothalamus, we observed increased nitric oxide synthase activity after spion treatment, which was reduced when they were exposed also to stress. We also wanted to know what is the distribution of the spions, and here I'm showing only the data from blood, plasma, isolated erythrocytes, and for comparison, left heart ventricle. And I'm not showing statistical analysis here because we still need to add more rats, but it was clearly only from four rats, which are in each group in this slide. The stress somehow reduced the response, the presence of nanoparticles in either in whole blood or in plasma. And when we went to the left heart ventricle and we calculated amount of the iron from nanoparticles, we could see that there is an increase when rats were exposed to stress on spions. In fact, this suggests that stress may increase absorption of the nanoparticles in the tissues on one hand, but also it can increase the excretion of the nanoparticles, maybe in the liver, or maybe via increased urinations, or via excretions through the kidneys. So this is something what we need to analyze in our next experiments. But when we took the tissues and from the liver and we determined hepcidin, ferritin, and divalent methyl transporter 1, which is a transporter involved in transport of the iron into hepatocytes and also to other cells, we could see that hepcidin was increased compared to controls in spion-treated rats, the level of in stress exposed and not stress rates was similar, and also ferritin was increased compared to control. So this increase of hepcidin and ferritin is typical for iron, when iron is increased. So it suggests, and the reduction was seen only in stress exposed rats, which were co-exposed to spirals. So this suggests that really after 90 minutes after infusion of iron oxide nanoparticles, it shows that the content of iron in liver can be increased. It is quite surprising because nanoparticles are supposed to be relatively stable when they are not exposed to some specific conditions, but in the cells when they are absorbed in low lysosomes and they can be exposed to low pH, it shows that maybe cold, polyethylene glycol cold is damaged, and also the iron can be released from iron oxide nanoparticles. And we analyze also the vascular function of the aorta because we have expected the nanoparticles can maybe damage the endothelium or vascular smooth muscle cells function in arteries. So this experiment is only after acute pretreatment of nanoparticles which were added directly to the chamber, to the arteries. And here you can see that endothelium-dependent relaxation of the aorta, which was induced by acetylcholine, was not affected by nanoparticles. But there is some shift of the curve, of a constriction curve, after norepinephrine treatment, which suggests that maybe vascular smooth muscle cells can be affected, or the release of endothelium-derived constrictive factors. Then we have also analyzed the function in the aorta from rats which were exposed to spirals intravenously after 90 minutes. This is a picture which shows endothelium-independent relaxations, which was determined using sodium nitroprusside, which is a direct nitric oxide donor, and it affects directly vascular smooth muscle cells. And it shows that spirals-treated rats had somehow increased sensitivity at low doses of sodium nitroprusside. But endothelium-dependent relaxation was not changed. When we exposed those arteries not to norepinephrine, we could see significant increase of constriction of these arteries. So this finding shows that in the aorta, endothelium supposedly is not damaged, but particles can affect vascular smooth muscle cells and to increase constrictions. We also analyze the femoral artery because aorta is the biggest artery and its function is a little bit different, and the mechanisms involved in its regulations are different. In the femoral artery, mechanisms are also different. So in this case, we use serotonin for preconstruction of the arteries, and there were no changes in the preconstruction. But when we analyze endothelium-independent relaxation using sodium nitroprusside, spinal-treated rats shows a little bit decreased relaxation comparing to control. This is in contrast to the aorta. And when we analyze endothelium-dependent relaxation, those two curves shows control rats and spinal-treated rats, and there were again no changes in the endothelial function. But to analyze a little bit more the mechanism, we pre-treated arteries with L-name, which is the inhibitor of endosynthase, and we again analyze acetylcholine-induced relaxation. And this is from control rats after pretreatment with L-name, and it was reduced compared to untreated rats, which is a normal situation, which we expected. But from the rats which were treated also with spirals and then with L-name, there was a significant decrease of relaxation in the femoral artery. So this picture shows that to keep the same relaxation, overall relaxation, the mechanism had to be changed. and it shows that spion-treated rat had probably higher NO production, but because when NO production was inhibited, the response is lower. So it means that NO-independent mechanism, like for example hyperpolarization, need to be increased to keep the same overall function. Now I'm moving to spontaneous hypertensive rats. In this case, we have determined only the blood pressure responses and heart rate responses and no stress responses. And it again shows that saline in control rats did not change blood pressure, and the same was true for spinal-treated rats where blood pressure was not significantly affected. When we analyze blood pressure at the beginning of the experiment and the end of the experiment, again, we didn't see any changes in controls and spinal-treated rats, but similarly to Vista-Kyoto rats, nanoparticles reduce heart rate in spinal-treated rats. We have again analyzed nitric oxide synthase activity in different tissues, but you can see there were not significant differences in NO production in any tissue which we have investigated, so not in the left heart ventricle, in the liver, and in the kidneys. We have also determined superoxide production, because I have already mentioned that oxidative stress is the most common negative effect of nanoparticles, iron oxide nanoparticles. We could see some slight tendency for increase of superoxide, but significant difference was observed only in kidneys, which again show us that maybe kidneys are affected with those nanoparticles. And we did the analysis of the femoral artery in this strain of rats. Again, there were no changes in serotonin-induced reconstruction. It was the same. There was only small change in the endothelium-independent relaxation only at the one concentration of the sodium nitroprusside, showing that it is just a really slight change in the vascular smooth muscle cells effect. And surprisingly to us, those two curves are from control and spion-treated rats, which were not affected. It was the same picture like in normotensive rats, but we didn't see any changes neither after the use of L-name. So this was kind of surprising for us, because we hypothesized at the beginning that high blood pressure and damage of the endothelium, which is normally present in spontaneous hypertensive rats, does not have a big effect on maybe incorporation of the nanoparticles to the deeper levels of the arterial wall. So to conclude my presentation, we have seen that there are early changes in the iron metabolism in young spontaneously hypertensive rats, which suggests that there is a possible involvement of iron in initiation of hypertension in spontaneously hypertensive rats. There was association between iron metabolism and NO in normotensive and hypertensive rats, and also there were age-dependent differences in iron metabolism, again in both normotensive and hypertensive rats. We have shown that the use of low doses of nanoparticles, which are similar to that which are used in humans for medical application, so it's a relatively low dose, may modulate blood pressure regulation during the acute stress in normotensive rats. And our data also suggest there is an absorption of the nanoparticles into hypothalamus, into heart, and also in the liver, which may be associated with the increase of iron levels, specifically in the liver. And endothelial function was not affected by nanoparticles, but there were changes in vascular function that could be related to vascular smooth muscle cells. So this issue needs to be analyzed deeper to see how nanoparticles can affect vascular smooth muscle cells. And we have seen that there are more pronounced changes, surprisingly, in normotensive rats compared to spontaneously hypertensive rats. And finally, I would like to thanks to my co-workers from our laboratory, to Peter Balish, Michael Kuknowski, to Andrea Berenio, Silvia Liškova, those guys, Peter, did surgeries in rats. Sylvia and Andrea did vascular analysis. Michal did all those studies with quantitative PCR. Martin did all those magnetic stuff and determination of the magnetic properties. And I would like to thank to our technical assistant, Mr. Jana Petrova. And finally, two grants which supported this study from the Scientific Grant Agency of the Ministry of Education, Science, Research and Sport of the Slovak Republic and Slovak Research and Development Agency. And finally, I would like to thank to all of you for listening my presentation.
So, question. Do we know what the genes are dysregulated in the spontaneous hypertensive rat? Is that known?
You mean to develop the hypertension?
Yeah.
Actually, this model was created in 1960, and there is a lot of studies about spontaneously hypertensive rats, but there is not one genetic change which would increase this blood pressure. It is the interaction of various genes, and in fact, until now, the moment or the cause why blood pressure starts to increase in a certain age is not known yet. There are a lot of studies which shows there is neurogenic hypertension which is related to central regulation of blood pressure, but there are also changes on the level of vasculature. But they are not, endothelial dysfunction is not the cause of hypertension in this model. But there is no one gene which is responsible for development of hypertension. And this is similar to human hypertension, which there is maybe 50 genes which are interacting for development of hypertension and not only one gene.
Actually, I have another question. Your spions, they seem to, if I understand this correctly, they seem to increase the effect of stress in terms of increasing the blood pressure.
Right. Yes.
Okay. Well, you know, one of the things, another way of looking at these in terms of therapeutics is, you know, patients who have severe hypotension or, you know, something like shock or something mm-hmm. like that. Would it be, do you think that these could have a role in terms of therapeutics in patients who have like sepsis, shock? That
to increase their blood pressure?
Right.
Actually, because we could see this increase only when they were stressed, not without stress. I'm not sure how we could mimic this condition, maybe with the increase of noradrenaline, but that's basic therapy.
Right.
And during the septic shock, what is the most important is the high release of nitric oxide due to monoxide nitric oxide synthesis.
Right.
And that is the issue. But even in this case, the inhibition of NO production does not help to those people. There were done studies with this, even in the hospitals, because in some cases there is no way to save the life of those people, and neither changes in NO production, inhibition of NO production can be changed. But I don't know any study if they will use nanoparticles for this, maybe with some specific treatment mount to that and to direct maybe to the brain. But as far as I know, during the septic shock, the vasculature is the main problem because there is a very, very huge relaxation and they are losing
right.
the condition or ability to be contracted
right.
because of high.
Yeah, and hypovolemic shock,
yeah.
the same thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, very, very nice talk and very novel. So I noticed in one of your slides you have the PVAT, the perivascular adipose tissues. So I wonder whether these nanoparticle has any role to play on those. And a follow-up, maybe you can choose to answer one of them. For the chronic kidney disease or the role of the kidney,
mm-hmm.
because it's always a problem. So when you put these nanoparticles with iron, do you think you are overloading the system? And to look also for the kinetics of that.
Yeah, we use very low dose. So suppose there is, we are not supposing that there is a huge overload with the iron. But our farming shows that there is probably some leak of the iron from those nanoparticles, because we could see changes in the genes which are involved in iron metabolism. And in the kidneys, we could see some oxidative stress, but we did not analyze closely changes in the kidneys. So this is something what we need to do.
And do they filter? I mean, how small or how big are they? Do they filter? They appear in the urine?
Sí.
Are they filtered through the kidney?
They are not supposed to be filtered because the size is 50 nanometers, hydrodynamic size, or 30 nanometers of the iron core. And this is too big to be filtered through the kidneys. Maybe there is, if there is some damage of the kidney, in that case maybe they could be filtered. But we did not analyze this yet. Actually, normally the nanoparticles are filtered with kidneys up to size 5 nanometers. So it's much smaller than we have used.
Did you see any immune function alteration?
We did not analyze immune function except of nitric oxide, which is not, in fact, immune reaction.
You showed in one of your last slides the hypothalamus absorbing iron. Since hepcidin is a peptide hormone, do you think there's any link between the hypothalamus that could regulate, and that's what it does, is regulate all the hormones. Do you think there's a link between it and hepcidin, or?
In this case, I'm not sure, but I would say rather not, because in this case we could see there were changes in the liver, and those changes in the liver are, in my opinion, associated with the changes in the genes, because we analyzed them in the liver, in hepatocytes. So this is probably not associated with the hypothalamus. But changes in the hypothalamus and absorption of nanoparticles to hypothalamus could be responsible for the decrease of blood pressure at the end of the experiment, because hypothalamus is involved in blood pressure regulations, or there is an interaction of those pathways for blood pressure regulation. So this could be, and it could be maybe dangerous for treatment, because through the hypothalamus, the nanoparticles could be absorbed to deeper parts of the brain. So this is something what was also quite interesting for us, and we also maybe will do more analysis for hypothalamus. The problem is it's very small in rats, so we don't have enough tissue to do all those analyses from one rat. But this is something what we intend to do.
Another question, sorry. Do you think the same phenomenon will happen in the salt-sensitive model of hypertension?
This is very difficult to say, because salt-sensitive model is a very specific, and spontaneously hypertensive rats do not have this kind of problems like in salt-sensitive rats, but maybe in that it is not possible to compare. And I didn't see any study which would use nanoparticles in hypertensive rats, specifically in salt. Sensitive hypertension. So I would just suspect, I could only speculate, so I don't know exactly to answer your question. Because it is a completely different model, not comparable with spontaneous hypertensive.
Thank you very much.